So, although it's related tightly to the previous talk, it won't be continuation. So just, if you miss something in the previous talk, you still have some chances to get it. Okay. So, I call it, so first of all, the kind of the most important thing to say, and then after that I can leave, that there is a joint work with Diophantine and Hofer. So there is a kind of extremely large project, and it's not really kind of mathematical work in the proper sense of this word, because there is a kind of enormous amount of kind of details have to be checked, and then it's kind of the new problems keep emerging and solved, and but so it's not yet kind of finished, and it keep developing in not only in technical sense, but also in kind of in the how they see the structure. So we use this word symplectic field theory, although I really kind of doing this responsibly, because it's maybe not field theory at all. So, but kind of connotation, the symplectic field theory, just because somehow it reminds topological field theory, although it is not, and also kind of the structure which arises extremely reminiscent to kind of to what we hear from physics. But I don't know physics properly to be able to identify it, although maybe people in the audience immediately say me what it is. Okay, which will be great, of course. So, our original goal was just to define some invariants of contact manifold. So, symplectic manifold were kind of lucky in the sense that after Gromov realized that just you can define invariants of symplectic manifold by looking at the by introducing some compatible almost complex structure with symplectic form and studying moduli spaces of holomorphic curve in this structure in holomorphic curve in this manifold, then kind of what he observed that when we changing almost complex structure in the class compatible with symplectic structure, then this moduli space, although it changed, but for instance, like its homology class in the class of all surfaces does not change, if kind of under certain assumption. And then, so therefore, this homology class is invariant. And then, of course, homology class is something not really something which easy to kind of to touch, so we would like to rather have numbers, and so to get out of homology class numbers, we have to intersect it with some complementary dimensional something, and this kind of thing are nowadays called Gromov-Witten invariants. And there exists this extremely beautiful theory of Gromov-Witten invariants for symplectic manifold, which kind of in relation with mirror symmetry and all kind of physics stuff. But kind of nothing like this exists for contact manifold. Although contact manifold is really necessary part of the whole picture, I just kind of, in my view, precisely the place of contact manifold in the kind of the whole picture, like the place of odd dimensional manifold among the whole all manifolds. So it's really kind of strange to ignore them. So, let me just say kind of what contact manifold is, although it's, of course, widely known, but kind of just could be people in the audience which never heard this. So first of all, we can have a symplectic manifold. So symplectic manifold, it's nowadays already in most kind of talks, it's not necessary to define. So it's a symplectic manifold. It's a manifold with non-degenerate closed two form. And contact manifold, you can think of as follows. It's kind of homogeneous symplectic manifold. So suppose you have a symplectic manifold, and suppose, for instance, that the symplectic form is exact, which of course cannot happen on closed manifold. And then you can consider vector field X, which is dual to to this primitive of symplectic form with respect to symplectic form itself. And this vector field has this property that if I take a lead derivative of omega along this x, then I get back omega. That's kind of equivalent to this equation. And which means that if you consider just flow generated by this vector field, you just multiply symplectic form by e to the t. So it's x by conformal symplectic dielection. And so if I consider this one-dimensional foliation by trajectory of this vector field, then and I take any slice, say V, transversal to this one-dimensional foliation, then you can immediately see from all this picture that if you take this form alpha, if you take a form alpha restricted to this V, and take, of course, this form alpha is not invariant on the flow. But if I take a kernel of alpha, so this plane field alpha equals zero, then this kernel is invariant under this flow. And therefore, what you get, this plane, so you get on each slice, you get some plane, codimension one plane field, which is invariant on the flow. And this codimension one field is completely non-integrable in the following sense, that in the kind of sense of sense of Frobenius, which means that alpha d alpha to the power, say, n minus 1, if n to n is the total dimension of the manifold, is a volume form. So what you get on each slice, you get transversal, you get contact structure, and that's what it's called foliation with transversal contact structure. So therefore, if, for instance, I can take a quotient space, then this quotient space is automatically contact manifold. It carries this non-integrable codimension one plane field x. And conversely, if you have a codimension one non-integrable plane field, so you started with odd dimensional manifold, and you have a plane field. Given by some one form, which I assume say it's corrientable, then you can always get it out of such construction. So if you take for instance, V cross R, and with, for instance, symplectic form D, with the form D e to the T alpha, then the fact that this form non-degenerate just precisely means that this field is completely non-integrable. And in this kind of cylinder, or rather it should be thought as a cone, this vector field x d over dt is precisely this conformal symplectic vector field. And on transversal slices, we get this contact structure. So anyway, just I wanted to say that contact manifold is a kind of, you can think of a symplectic manifold with this conformal symplectic action. That's the only point. So it's just really almost the same think a symplectic manifold. So, kind of, as I said, our original motivation was to study invariant of contact manifold. And for that, as Hofer already explained in previous talk, what you can try to do, you can study holomorphic curve in symplectization. Of course, it's non-compact manifold, so you have to consider holomorphic curve with certain kind of asymptotic boundary condition. But then it's kind of became clear that this thing fits in kind of more general picture of the following type. So suppose now we have a symplectic manifold W with boundary, kind of what I call symplectic cobordism between manifold V minus and V plus. So what does it mean that omega is symplectic cobordism? That kind of definition is the following, that you have a manifold V plus and V minus with fixed contact with fixed form alpha plus alpha minus, and such that omega is equal d alpha plus minus on the boundary. So it's equal d alpha plus here, d alpha minus there. And assuming that alpha plus and alpha minus is contact form, meaning that it's defined non-integrable plane. So in view of what I said, it's equivalent to say the following thing. So just to say that omega is exactly on the boundary and therefore near the boundary just means that you have a conformal symplectic vector field. And the contact condition just means that the conformal symplectic field is transversal to the boundary. And distinction between plus and minus is where this vector field exiting versus entering our measure. So symplectic cobordism is, in fact, it's not a cobordism. It's not equivalence relation because it has a very kind of determined direction of time. So it's not reversible. You cannot change it by, say, changing orientation or something like this. So, No, it doesn't help. It's only help with dimension two. Okay, so of course it's also a wonderful example, and one-dimensional contact manifold also important, but it's okay. So now, where this kind of contact cobordism come into kind of picture? So for instance, there are just really plenty of such things. For instance, suppose you have a projective variety. Actually, this can be done for any closed symplectic manifold according to Donaldson theory. Then suppose we have a hyperplane section there. So we have some symplectic manifold M, which is a just scalar manifold of projective variety, and it has a hyperplane section. And then if you take a tubular neighborhood, then the boundary of this tubular neighborhood is precisely of this type. That means that if I take a symplectic canonical of the scalar form, that this scalar form restricted to this boundary of tubular neighborhood of this N, it's exact. And this boundary is in fact contact boundary. And therefore, we can always cut any closed manifold into these two pieces. One will be will have so from the point of view of this neighborhood, it will be negative boundary. It will be a concave boundary. From the point of view of outside, it will be convex boundary or positive boundary. So now you can kind of cut it further because complement is a fine algebraic variety, and so it admits that the exhausting pre-recursive harmonic function, and then if you cut it according to level set of the function, you really can cut by elementary cobordism of the step. So therefore, this is a kind of piece, and which I would like to study, and I would like to kind of develop some kind of theory of holomorphic curve for this thing, and then have some gluing formula, and in particular, get picture for Gromov-Witten invariant of closed manifold in terms of all this kind of, in the spirit of topological field theory, and I will tell later a little bit more explicitly. But then, this is just motivation, but what the whole picture is a kind of, in my view, really kind of extremely beautiful, and which kind of appear when you consider all this object. And I'm sure it's probably good for something even more interesting than this. I just don't really know which question to ask. So this thing solving some problem which probably not the one which really I'm trying to solve. Okay, so let me now kind of become more specific. So first, I will kind of, without going to any holomorphic curve, I will describe kind of formal algebraic structure of the C. So what kind of theory I want to develop? So the theory will have three levels, kind of in, because I'm already using this physical terminology, then will be first classical level, then will be semi-classical level, and then, well, actually, why I'm using big classical level on this board, and then will be semi-classical on this one, and will be some quantum level on this blackboard. So, what will be in this classical picture? So we start with contact manifold, V, with fixed contact form, and also with chosen almost complex structure on contact plane field. So that means that alpha defines some alpha equals zero is some this our contact structure is a codimension one plane field, even dimensional, and J is this what is called CR structure. It's a complex structure on this plane field. Not non-integrable. Not necessarily integrable. So according as Gromov taught us for symplectic manifold, you have to impose some compatibility condition, which in this case means that the alpha should be positive on complex lines. So we start with this triple, V alpha j. And then with this V alpha j, we associate the following object. So in the all three pictures, we start with this V alpha j. And then what object we associate? In classical world, we associate some differential graded algebra. So we will introduce some variable. I will explain their meaning later, which I denote by two indices, Q, I, K, which will be kind of graded variable. And then it will be free commutative graded algebra generated by this Q and with some differential. So let's call this algebra, say, C of V alpha J, and will be some differential algebra. So of course, with D squared is equal to zero. So this will be just one object associated with this thing here. Well, I'll explain. So in this moment, it doesn't matter in this moment. I keep this notation only because it will, when I define them, they will come automatically with this indices. But in this context, of course, it's stupid to call. Just Q with some indices, doesn't matter. Don't pay attention to the two indices. It's algebra with unit. Okay, so now you have in this world, we have the same thing, but now you have a two set of variable. So also P, well, I still keep two indices, K, I, and Q. So like here you think that you have some space with this coordinate that's cotangent bundle of the space. So now you have a P, I, K, Q. And then what was the object which we have, we get a kind of just free Poisson algebra generated by these P's and Q's. And this kind of commutation relation not quite standard because here now already these two indices a little bit come into play because it's kind of, it's a Poisson structure which corresponds to symplectic form. Let's call it symplectic form capital omega, not to mix with symplectic form on our manifold pitches, just some K D P K I D K I. K enters the weight here. So you get this Poisson algebra, and then plus you get some special element, which I will call Hamiltonian in this algebra, which will satisfy this relation that Poisson bracket is itself equal to zero. Yes. So Poisson bracket equal to zero, which kind of sounds like stupid identity, but this is this non-skew commutative world, so this is not really kind of automatically always true. So, what? Okay, yes, there's a H, but this, you can kind of transform, think about this H as D, because you can then define differential DH on this P, just taking DH of F is equal F this Poisson bracket with H, which will be DH squared is zero. So here you kind of think that what is a differential algebra? You have a like vector field. You have this vector field, and this d square equal to zero. And in this case, you have a symplectic space, and you have a symplectic vector, Hamiltonian vector field. OK, and then, of course, this in quantized world, you will have the following picture, that you get what is called Weyl algebra. So again, we have a, like here, you consider all this operator, so kind of like consider element of this Poisson algebra. So it's like function of P and Q. Oh, I see. OK, so you're now asking hard question. OK, no, infinitely many P's and Q's. Infinitely many P's and Q's. And also I'm saying this algebra, but in fact, it's kind of completion of the algebra, because it's not just polynomial, but certain power series. But so I don't want to go into this. OK, so now you have this function of PQ. And now in this, you think about this as a differential operator, as a kind of symbol of differential operator. So that means that we think that if you take a PKI, and then PKI is in fact K times, say K times, well, H bar times G of DQI. And actually, I introduce one more variable H here. So then it will be some kind of polynomial of this, which operation is like composition of two differential operators according to this rule. Or you can just formally define it just as an associative algebra with some commutation relation that PQ is equal KH. So now, and you have such algebra, and then in this algebra you will define special operator that still denoted by letter H. Will be some, well, call this algebra D, because it's kind of differential operator. Then will be some special element H in D, and this H will satisfy the condition that H composition with itself is equal to zero. And in particular, you also can kind of define differential on this algebra, taking commutator with H. So dH of F is equal just commutator F and H. And it's again dH square is equal to zero. OK, so this is kind of what would correspond, what structure which associate with contact metal. Now, what we associate with the symplectic abortus? So first of all, suppose you have a symplectic abortism. So you have some W omega between this V alpha, well, say plus, everything plus here, and here everything minus. And I want to, of course, omega is just equal d alpha plus d alpha minus here, and you have an almost complex structure on the whole manifold interpolating between these two. So suppose you have such picture. Well, actually, I want a little bit more. Well, I'll say what I want more of how this J behaves near the boundary a little bit later. But at the moment, you have the J. And then you have here, with each of these contact manifolds, we already associated some algebras. Now I need to say, what do we associate with the cobordism? So in the classical world, we associate just some homomorphism between these chain complexes. So it's just C of B plus D plus to C of V minus D minus. So in particular, it induced homomorphism on homology. So now, here and there, things kind of becoming already much more interesting. So you don't get homomorphism between this algebra, but rather homomorphism of both of them to something else. Like, in fact, what we get, Lagrangian relation between them. So remember this, we had this kind of symplectic space. So we had this Poisson algebra, which I denoted by letter P. But let's also consider this space themselves, with where this P and Q are coordinates, this cotangent bundle. And so you have some space S plus associated with this boundary and S minus with this boundary. And always, and take a product, S plus, S minus. And like always in symplectic geometry, when you want to consider some kind of relation, you have to change sign of symplectic form somewhere, for instance, here. So you have S plus cross minus S minus. So now, in this situation, if you have a symplectomorphism, symplectic map of one manifold to another, you get its graph will be Lagrangian submanifold in the product. And if this symplectomorphism preserves our Hamiltonian function, then difference of this Hamiltonian function would vanish on this Lagrangian submanifold. So in this case, what we get? With cobordism, we will associate some Lagrangian submanifold in this product, which not necessarily graph. It will be some Lagrangian submanifold, but this Lagrangian submanifold, which also satisfies this property that if I take H plus and plus, well, probably minus H minus, I'm not sure about sign, but if you take a direct sum of them, then restricted to this LW, it will be zero. So you get, so if this thing, if this thing is graph, then we get isomorphism between these spaces together with vector field. In particular, we get isomorphism of homology. Yes. Yeah, it's correspondence, right? Why it's correspondence? Yes, it's maybe not visible that it's. Yeah, you know, in the situation, in the situation when it's. Yeah, I didn't say that. Of course, you're right. So you have to kind of study. It probably have some extra property which kind of tell you what the difference. But for instance, in certain cases, this even in the classical situation, it's an isomorphism. Even despite it's directed, still you can reverse it. So there are also some times you can reverse. So it's not all. It's not that it's always anti-symmetric. It's sometimes. Okay. So now, and in this world, what you get, of course, now everybody already guessed by this time that if in this world you get Lagrangian relations, and here you should get Fourier integral operator kind of relating this H plus and H minus, and indeed. That's what we get. So, you get here the following situation. So you associate with cobordism some function phi, let's call it W, of variables. I will write just P plus and Q minus. So it's a cobordism, and I will take this P variable upstairs and Q variable downstairs. It'll be a function of P plus and Q minus, and I consider the following kind of thing. As differential operator acting on variable, just thinking about this as a H D over DQ plus, and this is as H bar or minus H bar D over DP minus. And I just take this operator and just thinking, and I can apply this differential operator both to function H plus, which is a function H plus P Q plus. And also, I can apply this, it's not differential operator, of course, because it's kind of integral operator. Phi, it's actually Fourier integral operator. Phi W applied to H minus of P minus Q minus. So here you kind of differentiate with respect to P minus, and here you differentiate with respect to what? Yes. So you're right. You differentiate. Then you get function of P plus. So when you apply the differential operator to this one, you differentiate with respect to Q plus. You get function of P plus. Q plus and P minus, and you set Q plus equals zero. And you take this one, and then you set P minus equal. And then this is equal to this. And this is kind of analog of this identity that H, that it's relation preserved. So it's kind of in on the front level, this would give precisely this Lagrangian relation. OK, so this kind of this dream world which we want to construct, and we didn't construct it yet. So now I'm going to just explain how indeed this picture can be constructed. Oh, just one more thing. So this is what corresponds to cobordism. And now what happens if you take a composition of cobord? Well, let me stay a little bit stay. So what is 15 minutes I have? Okay. So let me say a little bit more about this dream world. So you want to understand what's happening when you take a composition of two cobordism. When you have one cobordism and then put it on the top of another one. And then what happens? In classical picture, of course, you get just composition of the corresponding homomorphism. In this picture, you get what is called composition of Lagrangian relations. It's kind of symplectic reduction picture. You just take a product of this Lagrangian manifold, intersect with certain hyperplane, and consider quotient. So you take, and here you get actually kind of convolution of this Fourier integral operator. So what you, actually the formula that you get in this case is the following. So you take a e. Well, no, I'm working on general manifold, right.
So we can find coordinates to define this Fourier integral.
Yes, but I have coordinates. Yes?
Then when there's a
coordinate, yes, it's becoming non-flat when you pass to this homology, but in this case. Right. Okay. Yeah, but what is actually interesting? What is actually interesting is that when you pass to homology, then you also get this either just commutative algebra or Poisson algebra or this kind of operator algebra. And this one is a quantization of this Poisson algebra. So in fact, you have a kind of big class of, I don't know how, just after listening, of course, to Misha's first talk, I cannot say that the word big class is really kind of suspicious, but okay, but but sufficiently big class that exists of really algebra which come with kind of canonical quantization in this picture. It's automatically they appear. Okay, so now what you have this okay, maybe I will not say you. I say that there is some kind of convolution formula that is not necessary to write. And just one last thing. What happened, I need to know what happens when you change on this board, this, I erased it, but all these objects, this, this function and homomorphism and this operator, all these objects are determined by choosing appropriate almost complex structure on W. And when I change almost complex structure, then things change. And I need to know how much they change. That's kind of crucial for understanding some invariant. And then the answer is the following, that in classical case, you get just chain homotopy relation, which, of course, like in standard homology theory. In this situation, you get something kind of complicated, I cannot say what. But in this case, you get something extremely simple. And so and then you can work out of this what you get in this Lagrangian situation. Namely, you get the following wonderful relations, which substitute this chain homotopy. So you get the following formula, that if you have an e to the power phi w 1 over h function, say, corresponding to structure j. And then you have a e to the 1 over h phi w corresponding to structure some j tilde, different different complex structure on the same coordinate. And then they're related via the following formula. So there exists certain function delta depending on variable p plus and q minus. And what you need to write down commutator of this and h direct sum h plus and h minus, maybe direct difference, I'm not sure. And then you take 1 over h of this, and you take e to the this. And now you think about this as a differential operator. You think about this is like commutation of two differential operators. And you apply it to this e to the 1 over h phi j tilde. And then you get this one. So that's a kind of version, what on the classical level, what you get chain homotopy, here you get this kind of thing. And in Lagrangian case, it's kind of, I don't know, I cannot write, probably there is no explicit formula. It is kind of difficult to write it down, because it's very nonlinear becoming. So now, let's build this world. Yes, you have to. You apply differential operator, and then all extra variable which remains, you should set it. Okay, so now let's build this one. So we have this our manifold V, alpha, and J. So first of all, already Hofer explained in his talk that when you have a contact form, then this contact form, you can associate what is called rep vector field, R alpha. So it's a rep vector field is a kernel of our D alpha restricted to V. And well, you can, if you wish, you can kind of normalize it by this condition, but that's already not necessary. So you take this kernel, kind of Hamiltonian vector field defined on our contact manifold as a level set in this symplectic manifold. So now this R alpha has certain periodic trajectory. And if I assume some non-degenericity, for instance, all periodic trajectory non-degenerate, for instance, then I have a countly many of them. And let me denote them by gamma ik, where I include also all multiple periodic orbits. And so gamma ik, so I assume that gamma i1 is a single periodic, simple periodic orbit. And gamma ik is a k multiple of gamma i1. So that's why this two indices k. So I just numbered simple periodic orbits, and then I have also their multiple. So now this, I will associate certain grading with them. So let me, I don't talk about the integer grading because it's a long discussion, but just Z2 grading is to say is very simple. You just consider Poincaré return map for each of this orbit and take what is called Lefschetz number, so determinant of identity minus this linearized Poincaré return map. And if it's positive, then it's even periodic orbit. If it's negative, it's odd. So, and then, just with each periodic orbit, I just associate two variables, Q, IK, and P, IK. So as a mode 2, they have the same grading. But integers, actually, they have different grading and not the same. P, Q have different grading. But I cannot discuss it within this talk. OK, so we have this Q and P. And so this is our Q and P variable in all three kind of versions. Now I need to define this differential or this Lagrange or H or this operator. So to do that, I need to introduce the following moduli spaces of holomorphic curve. So first you start with simplectization. So we have our W, which is M cross R. And now let's consider any monomial. So I'll call it M. So take any monomial of P and Q variable. So just product of some P's in some product of some Q's. And then, given such monomial, I consider this moduli space MM, and then say also some G. So now, actually, I have to say that I lied you all the way. Not lied, but I conceal kind of important things. So what are actually coefficient ring for all this, for all these things? So, well, coefficient ring, in the best case, is, say, rational coefficient or, say, complex coefficient. But in best case, if say, H2 of our manifold is 0, or at least C1 of our manifold is 0. But if not, then you have to consider, say, group algebra of H2 of our manifold, and in fact, not group algebra, but kind of completion in the spirit of Novikov ring of this. But I need H2 in the general, because I consider all Riemann surfaces, not only this. Yeah. Maybe you have to, that's kind of, maybe you can make some reduction. I don't know. I didn't study this curve. OK, but let's, again, for today's talk, let's assume that no H2 or C1 is 0, so this kind of problem doesn't arise. And so in this case, the coefficient is just complex number. So we consider this moduli space MMG. And this is moduli space which consists of just holomorphic curve. This, so you have a, it's kind of pair, FFJ, where F is a mapping of Riemann surface of genus G with conformal structure J into our WJ. And in fact, this our surface has certain number of punctures. And some puncture I call positive puncture, some puncture negative. And here, each positive puncture, it's in fact, looks like asymptotically cylinder over one of periodic orbit. So I have P's and Q's. For instance, I have PI1 and PI2, P1, 1. Oh, it's a very dangerous move to Chernoff's theorem. Okay. P to 2 is like Q, Q1, 1. So what that means? That you have a in this case, two pi. You take a two positive puncture, one negative puncture. No, we first just take a two sets of puncture. Two sets of puncture. And this puncture, positive puncture, you index by the same indices as P, and negative by the same indices as Q. And near each positive puncture, it looks like asymptotically cylinder over corresponding periodic orbit at plus infinity near Q at minus infinity. And you consider a moduli space of such curve. And then you take a kind of generating function. So you take a sum. You consider those moduli space which is in actually not zero-dimensional, but one-dimensional, because here a picture is translation invariant, so one means basically zero. And so you just, and then you count elements of this thing times M, times this monomial, and times H bar to the power G minus 1. And so, and this is your 1 over H bar H. No, in this case, in this picture, not. Because it's only zero approximation, and during my second hour lecture. Okay, but indeed, probably I exhausted all time. So, okay, anyway, so this is kind of where they come from, and indeed, all they satisfy all these relations. So to define this function phi, you precisely do the same thing, but instead of consider symplectization, you consider cobordism, and you consider the same thing in cobordism. But they have an answer, p plus orbit of one manifold to q minus on another. That's why they have this picture. So let me just maybe 3 minutes, OK? No? OK, then thank you very much.